All, I like to thank organizers for giving me this opportunity to discuss about diabetic foot infection with you. Dear friends, diabetics are prone to so many different complications, and of these, diabetic foot infection is probably the most important because this is where the maximum number of patients are suffering from. Diabetics are 20 times more prone to lower limb amputation. This is, and all other metabolic diseases are very common, becoming more and more prevalent these days because our society is in transition. Our eating habits are like this, and our exercise habits are like this. Probably this is the reason that these diseases are increasing day by day. Foot problems are a major cause of morbidity and mortality in people with diabetes. Diabetic foot is the most common complication of diabetes, greater than retinopathy, neuropathy, heart attack, and stroke combined. Throughout the world, foot lesions and foot infections are the leading causes of hospitalization and prolonged hospital stays for diabetics. 20% of all diabetic persons who enter the hospital do so because of some or the other foot problem. It is unwise to consider that major diabetic foot complication can occur all of a sudden. There is a gradual process through which Dr. Pinsey has already explained in a very nice manner about the biomechanics and how the things develop. The stages of diabetic foot are: stage one is normal foot, second stage is high risk foot, third stage is ulcerated foot, fourth is infected, and fifth is necrotic. The importance of understanding this is that at every stage, suppose if proper intervention is being done, we can at least slow down the progress to the next stage and we can save foot of the patient. Diabetic foot infections, which are infections of the soft tissue or bone below the malleoli, these are a common problem. In patients with diabetes, any foot infection is potentially serious. Diabetic foot infections range in severity from superficial paronychia to deep infection involving bone. Types of infection include cellulitis, myositis, abscesses, necrotizing fasciitis, septic arthritis, tendinitis, and osteomyelitis. Foot infections are among the most common and serious complications of diabetes mellitus and are associated with increased frequency and length of hospitalization and risk of lower extremity amputation. Foot ulceration and infection are the leading risk factors for amputation. And patients with diabetes are particularly susceptible to foot infection, primarily because of neuropathy, vascular insufficiency, and diminished neutrophil function. Well, about pathophysiology of diabetic foot infection, neuropathy has a central role. It occurs in about 30 to 50% patients or even more in our country with diabetes. Patients lose the protective sensations for temperature and pain, which impairs awareness of trauma, such as abrasions, blistering, or penetrating foreign body. Many a times it is seen that there is some foreign body in their shoe and they are not aware of it, and because of that constant irritation, they develop ulceration which eventually gets infected. Motor neuropathy, how it causes, how it contributes to diabetic foot infection has been very nicely discussed. Diabetic foot infection may begin superficially, but with delay in treatment and impaired body defense mechanisms caused by neutrophil dysfunction and vascular insufficiency, it can spread to subcutaneous tissues and to even deeper tissues. Although most diabetic foot infections begin with an ulcer, localized cellulitis and necrotizing fasciitis can develop in absence of an ulcer or traumatic injury. Well, this shows the mechanism. Neuropathy leads to loss of lack of protective sensation, and the skin breakdown is there, which may lead to infection. Trauma or excessive pressure again can lead to skin breakdown, and peripheral vascular disease also contributes to development of infection. What are different risk factors? Neuropathy, we have already discussed about it. Neuro-osteoarthropathy, pressure points are there, that has also been demonstrated. Peripheral vascular disease leading to ischemia, and there is poor healing of ulcers and poor healing of whatever, poor coverage of infection is there. And metabolic, because of hyperglycemia, there is decreased immune defenses and poor wound healing is there. What are patient and healthcare delivery factors? Patient's disabilities such as poor eyesight, previous amputations, they also contribute to development of infections and diabetic foot. Patient's behavior, they don't comply with preventive measures and hygiene is poor. Apart from that, probably we doctors and our healthcare system also is to some extent responsible, because there is lack of patient education, glycemic control targets are most of the time not met, and there is poor implementation of preventive strategies. About microbiology, the most common pathogens in acute, previously untreated, superficial infected foot wounds in patients with diabetes are aerobic gram-positive bacteria, particularly Staph aureus and beta-hemolytic streptococci. Infections in patients who have recently received antibiotics or who have deep lymph-threatening infection or chronic wounds are usually caused by a mixture of aerobic gram-positive, aerobic gram-negative, such as E. coli, Proteus, and Klebsiella species, and anaerobic organisms. Anaerobic bacteria are usually part of mixed infections in patients with foot ischemia or gangrene. In our country, where people who are living in villages and they are not taking care of their foot properly, and because of poor hygiene, anaerobic infections are also very common. Methicillin-resistant Staph aureus is a more common pathogen in patients who have been previously hospitalized or who have recently received antibiotic therapy. MRSA infection can also occur in the absence of risk factors because of increasing prevalence of MRSA in community. How we will evaluate a case of infection? Diabetic foot infections must be diagnosed clinically rather than bacteriologically, because all skin ulcers harbor some or the other microorganisms. The clinical diagnosis of foot infection is based on the presence of purulent discharge from an ulcer or the classic signs of inflammation, that is erythema, pain, tenderness, warmth, or induration. Other suggestive features of infection include foul odor, the presence of necrosis, and failure of wound healing despite optimal management. Local inflammatory findings may be less prominent or absent in some diabetic foot infections. For example, pain and tenderness may be reduced or absent in patients who have neuropathy, whereas erythema may be absent in those with vascular disease. Most patients with diabetic foot infection do not have systemic features such as fever or chills. The presence of systemic signs or symptoms indicates a severe deep infection. Visible bone and palpable bone by probing are suggestive of underlying osteomyelitis in patients with diabetic foot infection. Laboratory studies such as WBC count and ESR have limited sensitivity for the diagnosis of osteomyelitis, and we should not depend much on these investigations. The wound should be clean and debrided carefully to remove the foreign bodies or necrotic material, and should be probed with a sterile metal instrument to identify any sinus tract, abscesses, or involvement of bone or joints. Osteomyelitis is a common and serious complication of diabetic foot infection that poses a diagnostic challenge. A delay in diagnosis increases the risk of amputation. Visible bone and palpable bone by probing are suggestive of underlying osteomyelitis in patients with diabetic foot infection. Laboratory studies such as WBC count, they have limited sensitivity. Definitive diagnosis requires percutaneous or open bone biopsy. Bone biopsy is recommended if the diagnosis of osteomyelitis remains in doubt after imaging. What are the risk factors? Which are the patients who are more prone to develop osteomyelitis in case of diabetic foot infection? Appearance of swollen, deformed red toe, which is also called sausage toe. If bone is visible or palpable on probing, infected ulcer with an ESR more than 70 millimeter per hour is there. Non-healing ulcer after a few weeks of appropriate care and offloading of pressure. Radiologically evident bone destruction beneath ulcer. Ulcer area greater than 2 cm square or more than 3 mm deep, ulceration present over bony prominences for more than 2 weeks, and ulceration with unexplained leukocytosis. How we can establish severity of infection? The severity of infection determines the appropriate antibiotic regime and route of administration, and it also is primary consideration in determining the need for hospitalization and the indication and timing for any surgical intervention. This is classification of diabetic foot infection given by Infectious Disease Society of America and International Working Group on Diabetic Foot. If they have classified from uninfected to severe infected, that is from grade 1 to grade 4. Determining the grade of infection or severity of infection is important, because on that depends how we'll approach to the treatment of the patient. Any overlying necrotic debris should be removed by scrubbing the wound with saline moisture and sterile gauze to eliminate surface contamination. Tissue specimen should be obtained by scraping the base of the ulcer with a scalpel or curette or by a biopsy of the wound or bone. Needle aspiration of the pus or tissue fluid performed aseptically is an acceptable alternative method. And cultures of wound saps or material from sinus tracts are unreliable and these are strongly discouraged. To establish severity of infection, we have to assess vascular status also. Peripheral arterial disease can be diagnosed by absence of foot pulses and reduced ankle brachial index. Calculation of ABI is done by measuring the resting systolic blood pressure in the ankle and arm using a Doppler probe. ABI of 0.91 to 1.30 is borderline or normal. ABI of 0.41 to 0.90 indicates mild to moderate PAD. And an ABI of 0.40 or less indicates advanced ischemia. And an ABI greater than 1.3 suggests the presence of calcified vessels and the need for additional vascular studies such as pulse volume recording or measurement of toe brachial index. Patients, those who have got atypical symptoms or whose diagnosis is in doubt, should have ABI measured after exercise on a treadmill. An ABI that decreases by 20% following exercise is diagnostic of PAD, whereas a normal ABI following exercise rules out PAD. If a PAD diagnosis is confirmed and revascularization is planned, MR angiography can be performed for anatomic evaluation. Venous insufficiency can be diagnosed clinically by the presence of edema and skin changes and confirmed by duplex ultrasonography. We have to assess neuropathy also in case of diabetic foot infection. Touch, vibration, and pressure sensation should be checked routinely using cotton wool, tuning fork, and a 10-gram nylon monofilament. And there are instruments available like vibration perception threshold meter and heat cold sensitometer, which also helps to find out to assess severity of neuropathy. This is by the way of monofilament, how we check the for sensory neuropathy. Then regarding investigation, plain radiography of the foot is indicated for detection of osteomyelitis, foreign bodies, or soft tissue gas. When plain radiography is negative, but osteomyelitis is clinically suspected, radionuclide scan or magnetic resonance imaging should be performed. Combining technetium bone scan with gallium scan or white blood cell scan may improve the diagnostic yield for osteomyelitis. Magnetic resonance imaging provides more accurate information regarding the extent of the infectious process. Ultrasonography and computed tomography are also helpful in evaluating abnormalities in the soft tissue, for example, abscess, sinus tract, cortical bone involvement, and may provide guidance for diagnostic and therapeutic aspiration, drainage, or tissue biopsy. Now we come to the treatment of diabetic foot infection. Effective management of diabetic foot infection requires appropriate antibiotic therapy, surgical drainage, debridement and resection of dead tissue, appropriate wound care, and correction of metabolic abnormalities. Here we will discuss some common principles of antibiotic therapy, and depending on these principles, we can use antibiotics in a particular case. Empiric antibiotic regime should include an agent active against Staph aureus, including MRSA if necessary, and streptococci. Coverage for an aerobic gram-negative pathogens is required for severe infections, chronic infections, or infection that fails to respond to recent antibiotic therapy. Necrotic, gangrenous, or foul-smelling wounds usually require anti-anaerobic therapy also. Therapy should be modified on the basis of the clinical response and culture or susceptibility testing. Parenteral antibiotics are indicated for patients who are systemically ill, have severe infection, are unable to tolerate oral agents, or have infection caused by pathogens that are not susceptible to oral agents. Using oral antibiotics for mild to moderate infection and switching early from parenteral to oral antibiotics with appropriate spectrum coverage and good bioavailability and tolerability are strongly encouraged. Although topical antibiotics can be effective for the treatment of mild infected ulcers, they should not be routinely used. Discontinuation of antibiotics should be considered when all signs and symptoms of infection have resolved, even if the wound has not completely healed. Cost should be considered when selecting antibiotic therapy, because it is especially important in our Indian context because so many patients are not from the affording class. If medical treatment fails or if medical treatment is not effective, then surgery is an option. Surgery is the cornerstone of treatment for deep diabetic foot infection. Procedures range from simple incision and drainage to extensive multiple surgical debridements and amputation. Timely and aggressive surgical debridement or limited resection or amputation may reduce the need for more extensive amputation. Emergent surgery is required for severe infection in an ischemic limb, necrotizing fasciitis, gas gangrene, and an infection associated with compartment syndrome. Surgical excision of affected bone has historically been the standard of care in patients with osteomyelitis. Nevertheless, successful therapy with a long course of antibiotics alone has been achieved in 2/3 of patients with osteomyelitis. As infection is controlled and the wound starts to granulate, primary closure may be successful. The wound may also be treated surgically with a flap or graft left to heal by secondary intention or managed with negative pressure dressings. If the infected limb appears to be ischemic, the patient should be referred to a vascular surgeon. Although non-critical ischemia can usually be treated without a vascular procedure, early revascularization within a few days of the infection is required for successful treatment of an infected foot with critical ischemia. The wound should be dressed to allow for careful inspection of evidence of healing and early identification of new necrotic tissue. Necrotic or unhealthy tissue should be debrided, preferably surgically or with topical debriding agents. Removing pressure from the foot wound is crucial for healing and can be achieved through total contact casting, removable cast walkers, and various ambulatory braces, splints, modified half shoes, and sandals. Edema of the legs can delay wound healing. Controlling edema with leg elevation, compression stockings, or a pneumatic pedal compression device enhances the healing process. Evidence of resolution of infection includes formation of granulation tissue, absence of necrotic tissue, and closing of the wound. If osteomyelitis is present, signs of healing include a drop in ESR and loss of increased uptake on nuclear scan. Apart from all these measures, we have to take care of metabolic stability also. Correction of fluid and electrolyte imbalances, hyperglycemia, acidosis, and azotemia is essential. Good glycemic control may help eradicate the infection and promote wound healing. Blood glucose and A1C level should be measured at initial presentation and then at regular intervals. Frequent home blood glucose monitoring is strongly encouraged in these cases. Appropriate therapeutic adjustment, initiating or increasing insulin, must be made to optimize glycemic control. Other therapies such as mega debridement therapy or hyperbaric oxygen therapy, they are not commonly available and these are still in preliminary stage. Prevention is an important aspect in case of diabetic foot. Prevention of diabetic foot ulcers begins with identifying patients at risk. All patients with diabetes should have an annual foot examination that includes assessment for anatomic deformities, skin breaks, nail disorders, loss of protection sensation, diminished arterial supply, and inappropriate footwear. Patients at higher risk, their foot examination should be done more often. Educating patients and caretakers about proper foot care and periodic self-foot examinations are effective interventions to prevent ulcerations. Other interventions include optimizing glycemic control, smoking cessation, debridement of calluses, and certain types of prophylactic foot surgery. This is graphical form of what we have already discussed. I like to conclude my lecture by saying famous lines by poet Rabindranath Tagore. Sandhya Ravi ne pucha nab se, mera daitva lega kaun? Sunkar sara jagat reh gaya, niruttar maun. Mati ke ek diye ne kaha, main lunga naath, agar mujhe mil jayega, mere jaise apno ka saath. Dear friends, diabetic foot and diabetic foot infection, this needs a balanced teamwork between podiatrist, orthopedic surgeon, diabetologist, nurse. They all when work together, then we can get success in case of diabetic foot patient. When we will pass this journey of life, we shall place our footprints on sand. It is in our hands whether we want to make life of our patient a desert or valley of flowers. Take care of your feet and your patient's feet. Thank you very much.